All right, thank you for being here at New Hope for the last Sunday of 2014. If you are visiting with us for the very first time, there are some visitor cards in the pew in front of you. We would love for you to fill it out, drop it in the offering bag. Let us know of your attendance here today. Next week, through the mail, we'll send you information about New Hope. We promise we will not beat on your door or bother you on the phone, but through the mail, send you information. If you are a regular here or you've been coming for a bit, but your information has changed, your address, your phone number, your email, those kind of things have changed, please fill one out so at the beginning of the new year, we can get things to you in an appropriate way. All right? That would be wonderful. It is great. I often don't point folks out, but it is great to have Katie Coffin with us today, back home from her home state now of Texas. And it is just always great fun to see Katie here. She made my day. It's not that I don't like the rest of y'all, all right, but I'm a little partial. I'm just a little partial. Let me highlight a couple of things, and then we'll get engaged into our worship this morning. Thursday night happens to also be Celebrate Recovery Night, and it also happens to be January 1st. And so Celebrate Recovery will be celebrating with dinner at 5:30, and then different than their normal program. They're going to have a fun night. So if you want to come check out Celebrate Recovery, come on fun night, all right? And get introduced to some of those who were there. Next Sunday, first Sunday of the year, it is our homeless outreach. It's the first Sunday of the month as well. And if you have never been on the adventure of our homeless outreach ministry, why don't you give it a try the first month of the year? 12:15 over in the Murbach building, you gather with about 30 to 35 other folks. And go out. You'll be back here by 2:30 to 3 o'clock. But you will have an experience and a perspective that maybe will be very, very helpful for you. So we would love for you to try that. On January the 13th, the seniors at New Hope Church are going to help my sister celebrate her 65th birthday. That was a nice way to tell you all my sister is going to be 65, all right? It's senior lunch day, all right? So we hope she'll get there. So you all tell her you hope to see her at senior lunch, all right? She doesn't think she's old enough to be there, but she certainly is. Anyway, so... got that date done there. What else do I need to tell you? Oh, congratulations to Brittany and Gabe Schroeder. They had their first baby, all right, last week. So that is exciting stuff. They grew up out of our high school program. See what can happen eventually, all right, after you get your degree in college and become a doctor. You can have a baby, all right? But anyway, we are so excited for them. Thursday morning men's Bible study. If you like to get up early, then Thursday morning at 6 a.m. over in the Murbach building, we meet for 45 minutes, 6 to 6:45. We start on the money. We end on the money on Thursday mornings. And on January the 8th, we will be launching a new study for the year called All In, the book we sold out here, all right, for about a month and a half. That is going to be the basis for our men's Bible study on Thursday mornings, launching that not this Thursday, but a week from this coming Thursday. There's a thank you there from Angel Tree. It was there last week. We appreciate all that you did for all of our ministries during the month of December. And just a personal thanks for all of your well wishes, your nice cards, and your comments, and the afternoon that you came and helped me celebrate a birthday party. Tomorrow, I'm past it now, though. I'm over it, okay? It's no big deal. Tomorrow, 1 o'clock at Belmont Memorial Park, will be the graveside service for Naomi Millar, longtime member of our church, 94 years old. And there will be a memorial service scheduled later in January here at the church. Tomorrow will just be a graveside, but it's open. You're certainly welcome to come, but there will be an announced service here at the church a few weeks from now. Most of you probably heard, but Aaron Stonehouse passed away last Sunday afternoon. 34-year-old. We've talked about Erin. She was a Buchanan student. Baptized her here when she was 16 years old and had some struggles in life. But her heart was right with the Lord these last couple of months. Had some wonderful visits with her. An announced service will be later in January, maybe even late February. I meet with her mama next week, and those services will be planned. It was a special day for her mom. A tough day, but a special day. She was holding her in her arms, and they had been singing some hymns that were playing on a CD, and then the song came up, written, having a senior moment, written by Gil. Vince Gill, thank you very much. Rest high upon that mountain. And she passed away in the middle of that song. And so they're doing well, as to be expected, and just be praying for them. But we'll let you know when those services are scheduled. Della's mom, Della and Reggie, where'd you guys move to? You were right up here. You moved on me. they just came back from visiting Della's family down in San Diego, and then got a call after they got home. Della's mom is in the hospital and is on life support right now. So would you please be remembering to pray for Della's mom? And then I just found out that your dad is taking your grandmother to the hospital this morning. And so we want to be praying for the Smith family and Rich's mom as they are at the hospital at this very moment. So just a few updates that we wanted to share with you today. There are a couple of sign-up sheets that will be going around. At the beginning of the year, there's always some of these. The one on top, the white sheet, is for women who are interested in Bible study on Tuesday night. One led by Nan Isom here at the church. They're going to be studying the book of Jeremiah, entitled Daring to Hope in an Unstable World. And that's at 6:45 on Tuesday evenings. Please sign up so they have enough materials, and that is going to start January 6th. All right? And then underneath, this is for Hope Group. We are going to be having a new launch in 2015 on January 11th, right here and in the Murbach building. We want all of you who are currently in a Hope group, we would love to have as many of you as possible here that night as well. We're going to have you seated in here with your Hope group, okay? We certainly need a representative from every Hope group here that night, but we would love to have as many of you as possible. And then new groups are going to be formed that night as well. So if you can attend the launch on January the 11th at 6 p.m., and there's going to be dessert, okay? So come and join us that night, and those are the sheets underneath. If you're going to be attending, please sign up so we know we have enough dessert for you that night. All right? I'm going to ask our ushers to come wait on us as we have our tithes and offerings this morning. This will be the first and only time I will say this year. This is your last opportunity to give a tax-deductible contribution for the year of 2014. If you're behind, you could get caught up today, all right? And all of it's going to be used for God's kingdom work, all right? But thank you for your generosity to and through New Hope, not only for the needs here, but for the needs literally around the world. Please be in prayer also. We have eight heading to Africa in 34 days. We will be leaving for our two-week adventure. So please be praying in preparation for that. Let's pray. Father, for life, for this year, for the opportunities that you have been so gracious to give to us, we say thanks. Father, there have been times this past year that times were tough and you gave us strength. There were times this past year to where our hearts were hurt and heavy because of death and loss. And Father, you gave us comfort. There were times this past year, Lord, in which just the magnitude of events going on in our life brought discouragement, and you were there to give us hope. And so, Father, for those rich blessings in a troubled world, we say thank you. Father, the end of a year and the beginning of a new year is, it really is just one day becoming another, but it's also a time to where we can tidy up things. We can literally say, okay, this is the past, and I'm going to leave it there, both our successes and our failures. And we can say, this is a fresh start. This is a new beginning. So, Father, I pray that you will give us some direction in accomplishing your purpose in our lives today. We trust you with the needs that we've talked about today, Lord. We pray for Rich and his mom as they are at the hospital. You know the needs there. We pray for Della's mom and all that's going on down in San Diego with her. And we pray for Della to be encouraged by your presence in her as she is so far from her mom at a moment like this. Lord, we pray for the Stonehouse family and all that they've been through, and the Millar family, and services tomorrow. Father, we continue to lift up Mikey to you and the health challenges that she's been going through. Lord, those in our church family who are going through radiation and chemotherapy at the moment, and we pray for them and their families, for strength, for hope, for encouragement. And the way that you can use any of us to be your hands, your feet, your lips, your voice to them, may you find us ready and available. For the privilege of giving and sharing, we do so, Father, as a testimony to your sufficiency in our lives. We give it joyfully and gratefully. In the name of Christ we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Friday afternoon, Shelley said, time to put Christmas away. Time to bring 2014 to an end, and let's start looking at 2015. That's exactly what we're going to do today. We're going to pack away 2014, and we are going to begin to get a peek, I trust, into 2015. Bill Vaughn said, an optimist stays up until midnight to see the new year in. A pessimist stays up to make sure the old year leaves. I don't know which one of those you see yourself in. And maybe there's a little bit of both in most of us, all right? We're kind of happy to put a bow and wrapping paper on 2014 and put it away. And we're excited about unwrapping 2015 and see what lays ahead. A.W. Tozier, completely different thought process. Listen to what he said about an old year. He said, I do not advise that we end the year on a somber note. It's the march, not the dirge, that forever has been the music of Christianity. If we are good students in the school of life, there is much that the years have to teach us. But the Christian is more than a student, more than a philosopher. We are believers, and the object of our faith is the one who makes the difference, a mighty difference. Of all persons, it's the Christian who should be best prepared for whatever the new year brings. He has dealt with life at its source. In Christ, we have disposed of 1,000 enemies that other people must face alone and unprepared. We can face tomorrow cheerful and unafraid, because yesterday, we turned our feet into the ways of peace, and today we live our lives with God. The man who has made God his dwelling place will always have a safe dwelling place. It's a great way for us to end this year. I want us to look at eight. That is eight, right? Five, three, yeah. At eight thoughts briefly this morning as we kind of put 2014 to bed. I'm going to highlight these eight things real quick, and then I'm going to come back and talk about them slowly. For those of you who take notes, if you can't write fast enough for all eight things, I'm going to come back to each one of them. You can catch up then, just so you're kind of with me in the process. But first of all, we're going to remember our blessings. I think it's important before we put 2014 away that we look back at what are some of those blessings. Number two, we'll reflect on our spiritual health. How are we today compared to where we were last year at this time? Number three, let's review our habits, because it's our habits which determine our health, physically, emotionally, spiritually, mentally. It's the habits that really influence our health. Number four, let's take a moment and renew our vows of commitment to God, to family, and to our fellowship. Number five, let's refresh our soul. Take the time at the end of the year. We're kind of tired of all the activities that are going on. What is it that will refresh and nourish our soul? Number six, let's have a willingness to respond to God's leadership as we begin a new year. Number seven, this is the challenging one. Let's see if we will be willing to revise our personal agenda to God's purpose for our life. Would we be willing to revise our own personal agenda to what God's purpose is for our life is? Number eight, let's restore our passion for God, for life, and for the opportunities of 2015. So those are the eight things we're going to look at fairly quickly today. First of all, let's remember our blessings. Alex Haley. How many of you remember Alex Haley? Okay, how many of you have no idea who Alex Haley is? It's okay to raise your hand, all right? How many of you remember a TV series called Roots? Probably the same crowd. How many of you have no idea about the film series called Roots? It's okay to raise your hand. Okay, good. Two things. One, go to Netflix and check out Roots, all right? It was a challenging series to watch, all right? It was good. Alex Haley was the author of it. He became very well known as a result of that. But he wrote, actually, I should say, he had on a wall in his office a plaque that said this. Actually, it was a plaque that was a fence post, and it had a a turtle sitting on top of the fence post. And people would come into his office and they would say, "What is that there for?" And he would say, "Every time I write something, every time I read my words and I think, that's good," and I begin to get puffed up with pride, I look at the turtle on a fence post and I remember, he didn't get there on his own. Somebody put him there. That's the basis of thankfulness. You see, if we look back at blessings and think we got those because we did, then we're really not going to be thankful. We're going to be prideful. I did this. I deserve the reward. And there's no gratitude. When we realize we could not have accomplished whatever it was that we are considering a blessing, we are a turtle on a fence post and we say, "Wow, I could not have achieved this without." And we are very grateful. That's the basis of thankfulness, to remember that we got help from God and from others. And He is the provider from Him and through others for every blessing that we have. I grew up in church singing a hymn, much like "Precious Lord, Take My Hand." I grew up in church singing another old hymn called "Count Your Blessings." Name them one by one. Count your many blessings. See what God has done. You grew up singing that one too. So let's take just a moment. And let's count our blessings. What's the first thing that jumps in your mind as you think about right now something you are grateful for this past year? What is something that jumps in your mind?
God's presence.
God's presence. Good. It's great to say in church, by the way.
Good health.
Good health. Okay. Family. We're counting, remember? That's four.
A home.
Employment, job.
Friends.
Friends.
Graduating.
That a boy, Errol. All right. Finished college. Good job. Your wife. Good.
Still here.
But where we're going is not bad. All right. Take an opportunity to sit down, count them, think about them, evaluate them, be appreciative for them. Here's something that all of us who have faith in God, we have at least these three blessings. We have strength for today. We have provisions promised us for tomorrow. And number three, we have confidence when we face death. What more do we need? Strength for today. Provisions for tomorrow. And when death knocks on our door, folks, just a reminder, it's going to knock on every one of our doors. We have confidence to face it because the scripture says, "So great was your victory of death, where is your sting? They have been swallowed up in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and that is our hope." So remember your blessings at the end of this year. Number two, reflect on your spiritual health. We have a tendency at this time of year to reflect on our physical health. All right? How many is going to start a diet in just a few days? Huh? Oh, come on, be honest. It's all right. All right, you're going to start a diet in just a few days. You're waiting until New Year's is over. All right? And then you're going to really get after it. As most of you know, around our house, we did that last year. And in fact, we even did a sermon series, if you recall, middle of the year on the Daniel Plan, looking at our physical, spiritual, mental, and emotional health, kind of combining all of it together. I got on the scales yesterday. Okay, here's the good news. I am 11 pounds lighter than I was at this same time last year. Huh? Come on. That's good. That's good. My goal last year was to get to 165 pounds. I got to it for half a day. All right? That was my low. I stayed there really literally half a day. So here's the deal. I'm 11 pounds lighter at the same time last year today, but I'm also 13 pounds heavier than I was at my lowest. Okay? So, I'm better than I was, but not as good as I wanted to be. Okay? I'm telling you all this because I'm really not interested in our physical health at the moment. That's not my primary concern. It's spiritual. But here's the deal. I know where I was last year at this time. I know how to evaluate where I am in that process.
We do that physically. We often do that economically. But how often do we do that spiritually? How often do you take serious inventory of where you are in your spiritual development? So that when you get to this point next year, you can look back and say, okay, you know where you are. So I'm asking you to reflect on your spiritual health. Be more concerned about your spiritual health than you are your physical health. Because though it's important, it is less important than that which is most important. The Bible says it this way: outwardly we are wasting away. So no matter how much we work on this to keep it healthy, it will waste away. But inwardly, we are being renewed day by day. So outwardly I may look worse, but inwardly I can get better. Are you? Are you giving it a thought? Number three, let's review our habits. See, our habits often are a direct correlation to our health. Mentally, emotionally, economically, family-wise, and spiritually. According to Acts chapter 2, verse 42. Acts chapter 2, verse 42. There are four signs that show the child of God is a healthy Christian. One is, we have a heart that is hungry for the Word of God, to know the mind of God. Is your heart hungry to know God's truth, leadership for your life? Number two, a Christian has a desire to be involved in fellowship. How often do you like to spend time with the body of Christ? Number three, this is interesting. We observe communion. We'll talk about that just slightly in a moment. But you see, the Bible talks about the body reflected in the bread, the blood of Christ reflected in the grape juice, in the wine. He gives us this explanation. He says, every time you eat and every time you drink, remember what I've done for you. Don't ever become neglectful in remembering the great benefit that is ours because of what Christ has done for us. And then number four, we are devoted to prayer. Just so you know I'm not lying, let me read the verse to you. Acts chapter 2, verse 42. And they, the members of the fellowship in Jerusalem, that's the they continued steadfastly. What does that mean? Constantly, regularly. This was a consistent habit for them. What did they do steadfastly? They were in the apostles' doctrine, the Word of God. Number two, they were in fellowship with each other. Number three, in the breaking of the bread, communion. Number four, and in prayer. Four important habits for you and I to have and to develop. Without the power of God, there can be no lasting work done in the name of Christ. A healthy Christian knows that if the church is too busy to pray, that there will be a great amount of activity, but little accomplished. There'll be a lot of services, but few transformations. There'll be a lot of programs with little life-changing results. And I don't know about you folks, but as we approach into 2015, I do not want us to be a congregation that has a lot of activity, but nothing's being accomplished. I don't want us to have a lot of churches, a lot of church meetings, but we see no conversions, no transformations taking place in people's lives. I don't want to be a church filled with programs, but there is no eternal results coming from what we do here. I believe that is the reason that Paul wrote in Romans 15:30, I urge you, by our Lord Jesus Christ, and by the love of the Spirit, to join in my struggle by praying to God for me. Paul said, I know all of you back in the church in Rome, you can't go and plant churches where I am going to plant churches. I know you can't do that, but you can pray for me as God sends me to those places in the struggles that I face there. All of you can't go to Africa when eight of us leave in about 34 days. But all of you can pray for us as we go and we're engaged in that. And there'll be some engagements you will be involved in this year that we can't be with you, but we can be praying for you. It's part of what the habits, good, healthy habits are for spiritual growth. Watching the Knee, an author from about 40 years ago, he said, our prayers lay the track on which God's power comes. It's like a mighty locomotive. His power is irresistible, but it cannot reach us without rails. And prayer is the rails where God's power is irresistible in us. Corrie ten Boom. You know what I hate about getting older? Is nobody knows the same people I know. Corrie ten Boom spent, I believe, 3 years in Germany in a Nazi concentration camp. She was to have been executed on more than one occasion, and through God's providence, her life was spared, but many of her family killed. In her book, The Hiding Place, she writes this statement. It's actually a question. She said, is prayer for you a steering wheel or a spare tire? It's a rather powerful question, isn't it? Is prayer that which gives direction to your life? Or prayer, is it something that you use in case of an emergency? Only there when you want to use it. Someone else described it this way. Prayer is like art or music. It can only be enjoyed by and through those who have disciplined themselves to actually spend time in the activity of prayer. An artist or musicians cannot fully reach their potential unless they learn about and spend time developing their gift. Most people enjoy the benefits of looking upon artwork that much time has been spent and work put into it. Most adults appreciate the benefits of listening to a musician that has put a great deal of time and energy in their music. And so it is with prayer. With those who spend time in prayer individually and corporately and continually, who bless those for whom they have been praying. Paul put it this way in Colossians 4:2, devote yourselves to prayer, be watchful, and be thankful. He said in Romans 12:12, be faithful, consistent, make it a habit to pray. And then there is God's promise about prayer in James 5:16, the effectual and fervent prayer of a righteous person avails much. So how's your prayer life? Are you doing those things? Check your habits. Number four, renew your vow of commitment to God, to family, and to fellowship. Yesterday afternoon, actually evening, I was sitting in a chair in the living room. I was doing some work on this morning's sermon. And there's a resource that I have. It's a website that I can go to. That helps me run down facts and quotes and illustrations. And it saves me a lot of time because I can type in a subject and it will give me lots of options that I can glean from and pull from. And it's not a free service. You have to pay for it. And when I logged in, sitting in my living room yesterday, a little notice popped up and it said, your yearly subscription is just about ended. But no worries. We will automatically renew your subscription in 10 days. On the credit card, which we have on file for you, if that card has changed, please contact us so there is no disruption of plans. I sat there as I'm working on, actually, I was working on this point number four. Renew your vow of commitment. And they tell me, we will renew your subscription automatically. And I kind of, it dawned on me at that moment, I think that's how most of us renew our commitments, is it's just kind of automatic. It's kind of thoughtless. We assume we're still committed. Old story, you've heard, I've used it here, but of the couple who've been married over 30 years, and they're in the pastor's office for a meeting, and the pastor leans back in his chair and looks at the couple and says, okay, what are you guys doing here? And the husband looked at him and says, Pastor, your guess is as good as mine. His wife says, our marriage is in trouble. And the husband looks surprised. What do you mean our marriage is in trouble? Well, you don't love me anymore. Honey, I love you as much today as I did the first day I married you. And she said, well, you never tell me you love me. He said, I told you on our wedding day. And I haven't changed my mind yet. That didn't work, by the way, man. If you have lived under that philosophy, don't change that today, all right? Create a new habit. I think sometimes, well, you know, I got saved. I confessed my sin at some point in my life. I invited Christ to come look for me. God, I haven't changed my mind. I haven't done anything about it, but I haven't changed my mind. And we're still where we were when we got in. It's like the little boy who his mother tucked into bed. She went back downstairs for a little peace and quiet. She was watching TV, and about 30 minutes later, she heard a thud on the floor, and she knew that her son had fallen out of bed, and she runs upstairs, and sure enough, there he is on the ground. He's kind of wiping a tear from that. What happened? He said, "Oh, Mom, I guess I slept too close to where I got in." There's a lot of people who've gotten into a relationship with Jesus, and for some reason, you're content to stay right there. But how would you feel if you were a baby born at 7, 8 pounds? 2 years later, you're still 7 or 8 pounds. How would you like it if you were a 15-year-old still behaving like your 3-year-old? Oh, with a bad analogy. You get the picture now. You get the picture now. There needs to be this renewal, and it should not be automatic. We need to be engaged in it. And maybe one of the greatest challenges to renewing commitments to God, to family, and to fellowship is connected to this theme of forgiveness. Forgiveness. Interesting survey I came across. A survey done with 200 married couples, various stages of marriage, in regards to the subject of forgiveness. The researchers were wondering how one's ability to forgive others would affect their marital satisfaction and their personal well-being. And the results were rather astounding. The research suggests that there is a huge relationship between marriage satisfaction and forgiveness. In fact, it appears that as much as one-third of marriage satisfaction is related to forgiveness. Not only does the ability to forgive impact the marriage relationship, but it significantly is related to personal emotional distress. As forgiveness ability goes up, individuals reported fewer symptoms of depression, anxiety, and fatigue. These results are very powerful and suggest to us that not only secular counselors and faith-based counselors alike should be helping people develop the skill of forgiveness. If we have the willingness to forgive and do forgive, our personal satisfaction level goes up, as well as our relationships are better. So in your marriage, in your family, large doses of forgiveness. In the fellowship, large doses of forgiveness. Here's the deal. There's not a one of your marriages to where you are married to a perfect spouse. Not a one of them. Now don't look at your spouse right now. Okay? Because remember, what you just heard, your spouse just heard. Okay? Nobody is married to a perfect spouse. Forgiveness works. Here's another deal. There's nobody in New Hope Church who is perfect. There's not a one of us who are perfect. We all are in need of forgiveness and a willingness to forgive. And our anxiety goes down and our joy goes up when we give what we have received. We have received forgiveness from God. For our willful independence, we have received forgiveness from God for trying to imitate Him and be the God of our own life. And when we are able to give that which we have been given, the good stuff goes up and the bad stuff goes down. I don't know about you, but I kind of like that trade. So, y'all are forgiven. Just want to get that clear today, okay? I want to feel better when I walk out of here. Forgiveness, it's big. Ravi Zachariah, one of my favorite writers, in a book that he wrote called Light of the Shadow of Jihad, he said, what is the difference between companionship and communion? He said, in companionship with God, we come to Him recognizing our limits of strength. In communion with God, we stay with Him recognizing the depth of our spirit. In companionship with God, we long to see and to understand. In communion with God, we long to feel and to belong. Those who seek companionship without communion seek power without commitment, a display without dedication, and proof without love. May our commitment renewal to God, to family, and to fellowship include both companionship and communion this year. Number 5, let's refresh our soul.
What is the most refreshing thing you do for your body? Shower. Good. I'm glad most of you did that today. That's good. All right. Shower. That's one thing. What else? Sleep. Yeah. Sleep. That's good. Shower. Sleep. Some of you are doing that right now, too, by the way. That's good. Glad you came here. Got refreshed. It works great for me. Okay. What else?
Eat.
Yeah. Most of the time you eat, then sleep. Okay. So that works. What else?
Exercise.
What was that?
Vacation.
Yeah. What else?
Exercise,
yeah, good. And we're all going to start that and do it for about 3 days. A massage, huh? Yeah, I love my 555, okay? Good people. What's the most refreshing thing you can do for your body? Acts chapter 3, verse 19 tells us. It starts out pretty blunt. Acts 3, 19. Anybody already turned there? What's the first word? Oh, yeah. It's a word we don't like very much, do we? Repent! I said it the way the old Baptist used to. Repent! Repent you therefore. Be converted. In other words, be transformed. That your sins will be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. You want times of refreshing? Then repent! It is what David figured out in the Old Testament after his sin with Bathsheba and the murder that he planned for her husband. When David said, Lord, restore to me the joy of my salvation. Repentance comes before refreshment. In Acts chapter 31, verse 17, we get another insight to being refreshed. In the book of Exodus 31, there it is. Verse 17, it says, it is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. Rest brings refreshment. It is Jesus who said, come to me, all of you who are tired and weary by the pressures of life in this world. Find rest for your soul. Not just a good night's sleep, but for your soul, your mind, your emotion, your will. A lecturer was giving a lecture to his students on stress management. He raised a glass of water and he asked the audience, I can still bend over. He raised a glass of water and he said to his students, how much does this glass of water weigh? He had answers from 20 grams to 500 grams. He said, it does not matter the absolute weight in this cup, but it depends on how long I hold it. If I hold it for a minute, I'm okay. If I hold it for an hour, I will have an ache in my arm. If I hold it all day long, you might have to call an ambulance. You see, it's the exact same weight for a minute or for an hour or for all day. The weight does not change. But the longer I hold it, the heavier it becomes. If we carry our burdens all the time, sooner or later, we will not be able to carry on. The burden becomes increasingly heavy. Let me just be refreshed. You see, what we have to do is put the glass down. What we need to do is lay our burdens down. Jesus said, cast all your cares upon me because I care for you. Number six, respond to God's leadership. John Maxwell, a former pastor and now leadership speaker and author, says, it's amazing what can happen to and through ordinary people when God pours a little hardship and the power of God into the mix. One ordinary man, a little persecution, and a touch from God led to massive transformation in the city of Samaria. As Jesus had predicted, the gospel message made its way from Jerusalem to the outlying world. And Philip, one of the least gifted of all of the apostles, Philip illustrates what one leader with the power of God in him and the authority of Jesus Christ can do to change a world. And Samaria was changed. D.L. Moody said, I believe firmly that the moment our hearts are emptied of pride and selfishness and ambition and everything that is contrary to God's truth, the Holy Spirit will fill every corner of our heart. But if we are full of pride and conceit and ambition and the world, there is no room for the presence of God. We must be emptied
before we can be filled. Number 7, the hardest one. Revise your personal agenda to God's purpose for your life. A couple of questions. Do you know the difference? Do you know the difference between your personal agenda and God's purposes? If the answer to that question is no, then you have nothing but a personal agenda functioning in your life. And it may be a great one. In putting together your personal agenda, did you seek God's leadership? You see, that might be the only problem with your personal agenda. Your personal agenda might be very much the same thing, but if you didn't have God involved in the process, God has no responsibility to bring you blessings through your personal agenda. But if you take your personal agenda and say, God, I ignored you in this process. Here it is. What would you like to change? He might say, nothing. I just want to be a part of it. Or he might say, tear it up, throw it away. We're going to start fresh. He did with Saul, and he did with Philip, and he did with Peter, and he did with John. But he did it with Mary, and he did it with Martha. No radical changes. He just became part of their life. What are you willing to do? Is your personal pleasure more important than God's primary purpose? Do you remember the prayer of Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane? It's found in Luke chapter 22, verse 42. It's the night where he's going to be betrayed. It's the night he's going to be arrested. It's the night that he's going to be beaten and sentenced. And before all of that takes place, Jesus prays and he says, Father, if you would be willing, remove this cup from me. Take away the trouble I'm about to face. And then there's a big word in the King James. It's 3 words put together. Nevertheless. God, my personal agenda says, I don't want to do this. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. How many of you went out since I talked about this book 2 weeks ago, Unstoppable, and bought it at Majesty Christian Bookstore? You get one of you. Okay, more of you need to go buy it this week because I told Harry to bring some in because you would be flooding the store to buy this book. Okay? Unstoppable. The other one is Undaunted. Okay? This is the first one. Let me read to you just a paragraph or two. What's your appetite? What is your nevertheless? Over the years, I've learned that we cannot always be doing what we want to do, when we want to do it, or how we want to do it, and still be following Christ at the same time. There will invariably be many neverthelesses, not my will, but your moments along the journey. We must commit to being about our Father's business at all times, regardless of inconvenience, risk, or hardship. His business must always be our first priority. Your spouse may have abandoned you, but nevertheless, you'll remain a faithful parent committing to raising godly kids. You may be tempted to indulge your desires, but nevertheless, you'll remain morally pure. You may have the opportunity to misuse your access to funds at work, but nevertheless, you choose to live a God-honoring life. You may have been deeply wounded by another person, but nevertheless, you will forgive. You have been deeply wounded by another person, but you will forgive. Your boss may be abusing his or her power and mistreating the team, but nevertheless, your response will be above reproach. You may be tempted to walk away from ministry where you were needed because of relational strife, but nevertheless, you will choose to nurture harmony and remain committed to the calling. You may love your gourmet coffee. Crap, now I'm meddling. But nevertheless, you will feel led to use your coffee money to sponsor a hungry child. You may be longing for the next fix, be it substance, a habit, an online site, an illicit relationship, a purchase you cannot afford, but nevertheless, you choose obedience and freedom. You lay down yourself and you lift up your Lord. You choose to be last and put Christ first. You die to self so you may be in Christ. Nevertheless, there is no retirement from the race this side of heaven. Your passion can be refueled and your weary heart refreshed. Whatever your story, you are sorely needed. And what's more, your life will be far richer if you sprint now to the lane, take your position, and once again get into an exchange zone. As long as you have breath in your body, you can breathe God's love into this world. What's your nevertheless? What's your all in moment? How am I doing here? Oh, I can do this. I told you last week I was going to tell you about somebody in our church who came to an all-in moment. I will tell you this. To get to a point in your life to where you want to be all in, or you want to pray a prayer that begins with nevertheless, the reason that so many don't do it is because of fear. Let me give you a quote that hangs on my wall in the cowboy room at the house. It's a John Wayne quote. Courage is not the absence of fear, but it's saddling up anyway when you're afraid. Courage is what gets us past the fear. To pray a nevertheless prayer, to pray an all-in prayer. Many of us don't, because we're afraid of what God may lead us to do. I will tell you this. It'll be the most freeing moment of your life. The vast majority, he'll ask you to do nothing different. There will be some. 6.5 months ago, a portion of our elder board who work on ministry function of the church came to me in a meeting and said, Tim, we're shaping a new position here at the church. We'd like your input on it, your thoughts about it. And they unfolded what this position would look like. Not a great fancy name, but something like ministry director. And they said, Tim, somebody that can come alongside of the entire ministry of the church. They don't have to be an expert in any one area, but somebody that can come alongside. And they have the ability to encourage, to offer insights, to define, to develop, to do research, to keep life in the ministries of what goes on around here. To make sure that we are staying cutting edge in every ministry that we've got. As they talked about it, I got to tell you, that's an awesome idea. I had 3 people in mind right away. 3 people. I shared those names with them. Oh, awesome. We'd love either one of those 3. All 3 of them said no. Ticked me off. For about that long. I even gave 2 of them Unstoppable and All In. Guilt didn't work either. Wasn't for the purpose of guilt. So we've looked for about 6 months, just praying, God, who's the right person? Talk to a few others. 3.5 weeks ago, we get a call. Somebody in our church just read All In. And they said, Pastor, I don't know what this means, but I think I'm going to submit my resignation to my current employer. I don't know what God has in store, but I want to be all in for the rest of my life. Got a great career, but I'm not all in with God. I know this person. They actually don't live very far from me. I know what their current job was, but I didn't know anything else about them. I said, why don't you send me your resume? I'd like to know more about what you've done, what your background is. Didn't tell her anything about what I was looking for. I got this resume. BS degree from Purdue University, family studies, magna cum laude. I never got that written on any of my transcripts. Magna cum laude. Training and coursework of special significance, parent education, domestic violence, divorce, fundraising workshops. Master of Arts degree, University of Colorado, counseling, psychology, and education, magna cum laude, who's who among American colleges and universities. 2004, a graduate of Central Valley Business Incubator. 2007, Association for Healthcare Philanthropy, University of Wisconsin. Current work, Senior Development Officer, Stewardship and Move Manager, Campaign Coordinator. By the way, we're going to be going into a building fund process. This was just icing on the cake, all right? Development Coordinator at Children's Hospital, Marketing and Distribution Agent for her own company, Parent Education Specialist, developed ongoing curriculum for parent divorce bereavement support groups, facilitated share bereavement programs, organized annual continuing education seminars, created, can't read my own note right there, administer day-to-day operations in a footstep, mental health counselor for Women's Crisis Center, instructional aide at elementary school with kids with special needs, director of YMCA outreach program, and I'm just hitting a few of the highlights. I said, wow. I said, can we meet? So we did. I said, I want you to pray about it. I'm not expecting an answer today. And I said, but I'd just kind of like to know. I said, what's been your current financial package? I knew, because it's already approved for the budget for this year, so I knew what the package we have to offer was. And when she told me where she currently was, I choked. Because I figured after prayer and looking at the checkbook, the answer would be all, you know, I didn't realize all in meant poverty. I will tell you this, she's going from six figure to far less than six figure. But she said yes. So February 15th, New Hope Community Church has a ministry development director. I haven't called her name yet. It is Peggy Dunlap. Okay, Peggy Dunlap. So, February 15th, she will start working with our entire staff and church. And it was an all-in moment for her. It is a big step at a time in life when we are looking more for advancement. She said, it's not what my life has become about. All in. Last of all, we must restore our passion for God, life, and opportunity. I don't care how young or how old you are, if you are still breathing from this earth's atmosphere, our passion for God, our passion for life, and our passion for the next year's opportunities, that is a renewable resource. David prayed for it. Restore to me the joy of my salvation. Sin, Satan, selfishness, self-pity, bitterness, worry, these are all the thieves that try to steal our passion. And you and I need to have our passion resource renewed. We need to understand that God is far more interested in our future than He is in our past. Some people think God is stuck on our past. You need to understand, because of that right there, He doesn't give a rip about our past. He paid the price for everything that was in our past so that we don't have to live there anymore. He said, forget those things which are behind, our failures as well as our successes. Why? Move on to that which I have in your future. It's in our future where we're going to spend the rest of our lives. Forget the former things. Look for what God has in store in your future. Let me close with a Mark Twain quote. Mark Twain said this, 20 years from now, you will be more disappointed by the things you didn't do than by the ones you did. So throw off the bow lines. Sail away from the safe harbor. Catch the trade winds in your sails. Explore. Dream. Discover. Go all in. Pray the nevertheless prayer. Let's see what God has in store. I'm stoked about 2015. God wants to do some incredible things in His kingdom work literally around the world. And you and I get the privilege of being part of a little bit of that pie in a place called Clovis, California. And what we allow God to do here just will not impact here, but He can impact literally around the world. Nevertheless, are you ready to pray? Our Father, thank you for 2014. With its joys and its hardships. Thank you for 2014, with its promises and its problems. Thank you for 2014, for the lessons learned. Thank you for the mistakes that we can learn from. And Father, thank you that though December 31st to January 1st is just one other day slipping into another day, you've given to us in our human linear way of thinking an opportunity to put the old behind us and to have a fresh start. I pray, Father, many of us will be willing to pray a prayer that says, nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. We are in need of reviewing and remembering. We are in need of being refreshed and recommitted.
we are in need of reflecting your glory in the world. God, may we give you permission to do so in us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a great afternoon. See you next year. And